So before we really get into this, we'd like to acknowledge the people who were stewards of this land before us. I'm currently in Port Rowan, which is on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee peoples, and Heather.
And I'm joining you from Waterloo, Ontario, the current and traditional lands of Mississauga, Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, Neutral People, Haudenosaunee, and Anishinaabe. This territory is covered by the Haldimand Treaty of 1784 and Treaty 3 from 1873.
So First Canada understands that Indigenous voices, knowledge, and ongoing work on the land are critical for wild birds to thrive in sustainable ecosystems. We gratefully support the needs, aspirations, and rights of Indigenous peoples that care for this land. So Heather and I both work for Birds Canada, as we mentioned, and this is a nonprofit organization dedicated to the research, conservation, and education of birds. So our mission at Birds Canada is to drive action to increase the understanding, appreciation, and conservation of birds in Canada through scientific research, innovative partnerships, public engagement, science-based advocacy, and on-the-ground action. But what are aerial insectivores? So aerial insectivores are a group of birds that catch insects while in flight. Here I have a tree swallow, a northern ruffling swallow, cliff swallow, purple martin, barn swallow, bank swallow, and chimney swift. But this group also includes species of flycatchers as well as nightjars. Because of their insect eating strategies, aerial insectivores spend most of their time in flight, and their bodies are perfectly built for this lifestyle. They have long wings, a short beak, big eyes for spotting insects, and short legs because, well, who needs long, strong legs when you spend all your time flying? They typically also have shorter necks, so anybody that's had any experience bird banding, they just feel way different in the hand than like a warbler or any of those sort of things. All of these features add up to make these birds absolutely amazing aerial acrobats, as well as speedy flyers. When we were doing boat surveys earlier this year, bank swallow was flying along beside the boat and was keeping right up with us at 23 kilometers an hour, which I thought was really impressive for a bird that's about this big. These birds have a voracious appetite for insects, and they're migratory, meaning they spend their summers in North America and fly south for the winter. And unfortunately, this group is at risk.
So we know aerial insectivores are at risk, but how at risk are they, and why are they at risk? Well, using nearly 50 years of data, the 2019 State of Canada's Birds Report shows that Canada has lost between 40 and 60% of shorebird, grassland bird, and aerial insectivore populations, with aerial insectivores having the steepest decline of 59%. Over the last 10 years, 80% of the species newly listed as threatened or endangered in Canada were aerial insectivores. However, one positive thing this report shows us is how conservation efforts can work. Many species of waterfowl and birds of prey were at risk, but hunting regulations and banning DDT have helped these populations rebound. So all is not lost for the aerial insectivores. So why are aerial insectivores declining at such an alarming rate? The reasons are not fully yet understood, but one major threat is the decline of aerial insects, their food source. Insects are declining across the globe due to an increase in intensive agriculture, climate change, and habitat loss. Intensive agriculture is the switch from small, diversified crop farms to large monoculture or one crop farms. Monoculture farms require more pesticides than diverse farms because the reduced diversity of crops, The reduced diversity of crops also reduces the insect diversity that a farm can support. A reduction in insect diversity throws off natural systems in place that keep populations balanced, often leading to an outbreak in one species of pest that is further controlled by more pesticides. The shift in insect diversity and abundance affects aerial insectivores. For example, a study from 2012 looking at chimney swift poop found that their prey source had shifted. The researchers noticed less coloptera or beetle remains and more hemipteras or true bug remains in the chimney swift poop. Beetles are the preferred food of aerial insectivores as they have a higher caloric value, meaning birds have to eat less of them to sustain their energy. True bugs, however, have a lower caloric value, meaning aerial insectivores have to forage for longer to get enough calories. This is concerning because it takes energy to catch prey, so the adults could have a net loss of energy when foraging on true bugs alone. The authors of the study argued that heavy use of DDT had decimated the clothra or beetle populations by the 1960s, leading to this drastic prey shift in chimney swifts. DDT is a non-selective insecticide, meaning it could kill any species of insect that it comes in contact with, and it was heavily used in North America until it was banned in 1972. You may know DDT as the main cause of decline for bald eagles and peregrine falcons, which was part of why it got banned in 1972. Climate change is also impacting insect-bird relations by causing a phenological mismatch between birds and insects. A phenological mismatch is when interacting species change the timing of regularly repeated phases in their life cycles at different rates. For example, birds and insects use changes in the amount of daylight, food and food abundance and temperature as cues for their life cycles. When days are shorter and temperatures are cooler in South America, birds begin to migrate to their breeding grounds. At the same time, insects in Canada have warmer, longer days, triggering their next phase of their life cycle. Aerial insectivores have evolved with insects to arrive and breed during peak adult insect abundance. However, with climate change, seasonal cues may come earlier or later for insects or birds. So the timing between peak insect abundance and peak breeding bird season could no longer line up. This can have devastating impacts on nestling survival rates and on the number of attempted nests per breeding season. And finally, the conversion of breeding habitats such as forests, grasslands, and wetlands to human landscapes is limiting the amount of available breeding habitat for insects. Climate change is also directly impacting aerial insectivore populations by creating more unpredictable and intense storms that can damage important habitats and blow migratory birds off course. Like Hurricane Wilma in 2005, which moved thousands of birds off course to Western Europe, including several hundred chimney swifts. The next year, chimney swift populations had declined by half of what it was the year before the storm. Further threats include the loss of breeding habitat across Canada and the loss of overwintering habitat in South America as human development continues to encroach on natural spaces. Now we will take a closer look at family groups within the aerial insectivore group of birds. I will start off with a brief overview of flycatchers and nightjars. These family groups are less associated with human landscapes than other aerial insectivores that we will focus on today. Canada has several species of flycatcher, which are listed here. The asterisks indicate the two species that are at risk in Canada, the Acadian flycatcher, which is listed as endangered, and the olive-sided flycatcher, which is listed as threatened. Many of these species look similar, and some can only be identified by song or by using an equation involving wing and tail measurements. Flycatchers are more easily monitored through our national programs, such as the Breeding Bird Survey, than our other focus species. Canada has three species of nightjar, again listed here. The eastern whippoorwill is listed as threatened, and the common nighthawk is special concern. These species are either crepuscular, meaning they are most active at dusk and dawn, or nocturnal, meaning they are active at night, making them a little bit more difficult to see than other birds. They are also excellent at blending into nature, which makes them even more difficult to see. But thankfully, they're often easy to hear during their active times. In the two pictures in the bottom, you can see that they have really small looking bills, but they actually have these huge mouths that are able to eat large moths and insects. Nightjars are currently monitored in our Canadian Nightjar Survey. Now I will talk about swifts. Canada has four species of swift, including the black swift and white-throated swift that are listed as endangered, but live on the west coast of Canada. The Vox's swift, also on the west coast and not currently at risk, and finally the chimney swift, which I will be talking more about today. Chimney swifts are often called a cigar with wings. They have dark gray-brown tube-shaped bodies with a slightly paler throat. Females and males look identical, except that males tend to be slightly heavier. The chimney swift belongs to the Apodidae family, which means footless, referring to the fact that chimney swifts can't perch on branches like the other birds we see in our backyards. They can only cling to vertical surfaces. They spend their entire day flying and foraging insects, eating upwards of 1,000 a day. Chimney swifts that visit Canada spend their winter in South America. They begin the spring migration around March and nest in Canada from May to August, when they begin their fall migration back to South America. During migration, they fly high in the sky during the day and rest in chimneys at night, often in large groups ranging from a few individuals to several thousand. They are listed as threatened in Canada. Chimney swifts nest and roost in cavities. Historically, they were adapted to large old growth trees with hollow cavities. However, as human landscapes continued to spread and old growth forests disappeared, chimney swifts adapted to chimneys. They can use barn silos, rock crevices, and sometimes wells for nesting as well. Chimney swifts nest in pairs or sometimes have juvenile helpers and will often roost in their nest chimney at night. The term roost refers to where swifts and swallows congregate at night to rest. For many swallow species, roost sites are wetlands where mixed species will congregate, providing safety in numbers. But for chimney swifts, roost sites are chimneys. Chimney swifts are ready for breeding when they are 2 years old. They form seasonally monogamous pairs and will often return to the same nesting site every year. Their nests are made with glue-like saliva and twigs stuck to the inside of the chimney, and they have an average of 4 eggs per clutch.
And next, I'm going to talk to you about swallows. So first, we have the bank swallow, which is a small bird, even within the aerial insectivore group. These birds have a wingspan of 25 to 33 centimeters and only weigh about 14 grams, which for reference is about the same as 2 loonies. Each loonie weighs 7 grams. These birds are brown with a pure white front other than a little brown necklace, and both the male and female look the same. They're called bank swallows because of their breeding habitat, which is in sandy banks where they dig burrows to build their nests. These birds breed in the northern U.S. and southern Canada, like many other species of aerial insectivores, and then they fly south for the winter following the insects. Unfortunately, bank swallows are federally listed as threatened. Sorry. bank swallows are known to forage from dusk to dawn over lakes, ponds, rivers, meadows, fields, pastures, and bogs, basically anywhere there's insects. They communally roost in mixed species flocks and wetlands. So like I'm right near Long Point, so there's a huge roost site by Long Point where in all the cattail marshes with barn swallows, there'll be some purple martins, some tree swallows, they all kind of hang out in there. Bank swallows nest in sandy / loose substrate near vertical embankments along ocean coasts, lakes, streams, rivers, and wetlands. Both the male and the female work together to dig the burrow. Literature mostly says that it's just the male, but from observation banding, both the male and the female will have dirt on their claws and on their face. The males might be slightly dirtier, but both are definitely involved in the nest building process. And we can tell male or female based on the presence of a brood patch or a cloacal protrusion. So that's my own observation there. And then the females are known to collect a lot of the roots, grass, and feathers and all that stuff. But again, it seems like a team effort from my own observations. Besides natural embankments, bank swallows will nest in walls with tubes, it's like artificial habitat, as well as in pits and quarries. But again, my own observations, I've seen that to not be quite as common as in natural habitats like the tubes. This might be something that's more common in the Atlantic or maybe even the UK, where they've had more luck with artificial structures. Bank swallows begin breeding at about 2 years old, and they have a high site fidelity, meaning they tend to return to the same breeding sites year after year. They're colonial nesters and will nest in groups of thousands or 10. I found that colonies tend to be a lot smaller in pits and quarries than on lakeshore sites, like these big natural sites. But I've also only really studied the lakeshore site on the north shore of Lake Erie, which has one of the largest concentrations of bank swallows in the world. Our count this past year, like field season, was about 92,000 birds from Wheatley, so up near Point Pelee, all the way to Nanticoke in Ontario. So we drove along the North Shore and surveyed that whole stretch. Next is the barn swallow. This bird is the inspiration for the classic swallow tattoo that I'm sure many of you are familiar with. And if you're going to get a tattoo of a bird, it's really not a bad choice because barn swallows are gorgeous. They have a blue back, wings, and tail with a rust orange breast, and of course the infamous forked swallow tail. From a distance, the males and females are virtually identical, but in the hand, males are more brightly colored and they tend to have longer tails as this is a feature that females seem to select for. Legend has it that the barn swallow got its forked tail when it stole fire from the gods to bring back to humanity. According to this legend, an angry god hurled a brand of fire at the barn swallow, which singed off its middle tail feathers. I don't know where this legend came from, but I thought it was kind of cool. Barn swallows inhabit a fairly similar area to bank swallows, though they cover more territory and have a more predominant western presence, which makes sense because historically they nested mostly in caves. Like the bank swallow, barn swallows are federally listed as threatened. Barn swallows forage over open areas such as grassy pastures, fields, and wetlands. This species will roost with other types of swallows during migration, similar to the bank swallow, and pairs will often sleep together in nests, which could be made on crossbeams and eaves of sheds, barns, or stables, as well as bridges, culverts, basically anything with shelter and a perch. What's really fun about barn swallows, though, is that they're actually known to exhibit play, which I thought was pretty adorable. Barn swallows will build cup-shaped nests out of mud, typically on human structures, but as I mentioned, historically they made their nests in caves. They'll lay 3 to 7 eggs and will have 1 or 2 broods of chicks a year, though they'll also occasionally have a third brood. Next is the crest swallow. This species is probably my husband's least favorite type of bird because they keep nesting under our roof line and they poop all over our windows. I think it's fantastic to be able to look out of my window directly at a family of cliff swallows, but he really struggles with the poop, which I'm sure many of you can relate to. I think it's totally worth it, especially because my daughter can now identify cliff swallows because she's so used to seeing them flying right by her window. But anyways, fortunately, they're only there for a few months, so can't be too upset about that. These birds look quite similar to barn swallows, except for they don't have the forked tail. They have an orange rump, and they have a white forehead or a faux hawk. These birds also make mud nests, but unlike the barn swallow, these nests are shaped like an upside-down igloo, not a cup. Tree swallows are another bird close to my heart. They are a gorgeous bright blue with a white belly, though young females can look a bit greenish instead of blue. While they historically nested in tree cavities, they pretty well entirely transitioned to nest boxes. These birds are fairly territorial and like a bit of space between other nesting tree swallows, and they will dive bomb anyone that comes near their nest, which can be a little unnerving when you're doing nest checks. I swear you can feel the wind off of them swooping by your head, but nobody's going to be more surprised than a tree swallow if they actually hit you, so they're all bark and no bite. Tree swallows seem to do really well in nest boxes near lakes, farms, or grasslands where there are lots of insects. Purple martins are the largest swallow species. As their name suggests, they are purple in color with brownish black wings, though younger birds can have a bit of a white hue. Purple martins also historically nested in tree cavities, but they've almost entirely switched over to nest boxes as well. There are even records of indigenous peoples hollowing out gourds to make houses for purple martins hundreds of years before settlers started doing it, which is quite cool. Lastly, we have the northern rough-winged swallow, and these birds are honestly a bit of an enigma. They look very similar to bank swallows, but they're slightly larger, and they do not have the little necklace. These birds nest in burrows created by other animals such as kingfishers, bank swallows, and squirrels. While they inhabit very similar areas to bank swallows, they're not colonial. And while they can be found in gravel pits and sandy bluffs, I've had more luck in rivers and stream habitat, especially nesting under bridges, so like near a culvert. Rough-winged swallows get their names from the tiny hooks on the leading edge other primary feathers. It honestly feels a lot like Velcro. What's really cool though is we don't know why they have this rough wing. So any aspiring ornithologist, there's a research question for you.
So now that we know more about aerial insectivores, I will discuss specific threats that our target species at risk face in addition to the general threats that were already discussed. So as humans cleared old growth trees and replaced them with brick houses, chimney swifts adapted to brick chimneys. Unfortunately, modern houses and safety regulations are changing, and houses are being built with lining and chimney caps, preventing chimney swifts from nesting in them. Many houses are also being built without masonry chimneys, further decreasing the amount of available nesting habitat for chimney swifts. Bank swallows face more direct impacts from climate change because of increased storm surges comes increased erosion along coastal shorelines and riverbanks where these birds nest. Increased erosion can make banks and shorelines too unstable for nesting and can make already established colonies collapse. The negative impact of increased erosion is heightened by coastal landowners choosing to rock armor their property. Like in this picture, rock armoring involves using cement or large rocks to create a wall between the eroding land and the water, blocking bank swallows entirely from nesting in these areas. For barn swallows, one main threat they face is the loss of older wood barns and buildings, which are being replaced with modern barns made from steel, aluminum, vinyl, or concrete. While barn swallows can still nest in these buildings made from these materials, there are some potential issues. For example, metal buildings, especially with metal roofs, create a higher ambient temperature in the nest during peak heat than wood roofs, which could become too hot for the chick. Further, metal buildings also lose heat quicker at night, making the ambient temperature of nests cooler, also posing a threat to nestlings. Barn swallows can nest in concrete buildings, but they need irregularities and ledges to build a nest on, which are not always there.
But what's being done about all these threats? Well, Birds Canada is doing quite a lot, actually. In both Ontario and the Maritimes, we have Swiss Watch programs, which started in 2010 and are based on the participation of volunteers and landowners. Some of our project partners are in Quebec, Manitoba, and the U.S. Swoop Watch's goal is to monitor chimney swift roosts and nest sites, as well as support habitat stewardship. So we identify long-term population trends, evaluate the effectiveness of conservation actions. We engage citizen scientists and partners to locate nest and roost sites, and we help landowners steward chimney swift habitat, and we facilitate research. Swift Watch is a largely volunteer-based program, like almost entirely volunteer-based, and if anybody is interested in helping monitor swifts, which there's been a couple of questions about it, please talk to us afterwards, because we are very, very grateful for all of our volunteers. Birds Canada also helps facilitate the Chimney Swift Fund. It's too late this year, but there is funding available to match up to 1-to-1 for applicants to help them repair the chimneys to keep them swift friendly, which is pretty cool. Birds Canada is also heavily involved in bank swallow research. This summer, we were capturing bank swallows and banding them and putting MODIS tags on them to help estimate the survival of adult and juvenile birds. MODIS tags, if you're not familiar, are basically like radio tags. They send out a pulsing signal when the bird flies past a MODIS tower. The tower pings it and we can tell where the bird is going. We also took feather samples from these birds, and these feathers will be used in an isotopic analysis, which will show us where the bird hatched, where the bird spent the winter, and essentially help us get a better picture of their migration and migratory connectivity, which in turn helps us to figure out what exactly is causing their declines, because there's so many different things coming at them that we're not sure what is causing it, like specifically. We've also been doing population surveys along the north shore of Lake Erie, which, as I've mentioned, holds one of the largest concentrations of bank swallows in the world. We drive along Lake Shore in a boat counting the burrows. A study in 2011 showed that approximately 50% of the burrows are occupied. Since each occupied burrow would have two birds, one male and one female, we use the number of birds as an approximate number of the breeding bank swallows in the colony. So this survey has been going on since 2010. And as you can see, the results are a little depressing. The red line in the graph, or sorry, in the map, shows where we typically do the surveys, from Clear Creek to Port Stanley. And in 2011, a survey was conducted along the whole yellow stretch from Point Keeley to Dunville. However, with the population declining so much, this year we decided to survey the whole shoreline again to make sure that the population was actually declining and the birds hadn't just shifted there where they were breeding, because the habitat might change over 10 years. So we surveyed the whole shoreline, and it turns out that they did shift. There was another 20,000 bank swallows just west of our normal survey, meaning that rather than having a population count of 60,000 for this year, we had a count of 80,000 in a very similar stretch, which is extremely encouraging, because instead of our counts going from about 100,000 bank swallows in 2010, they've dropped to 80,000, not to 60,000, which is a huge win for the bank swallows. And it's a very good story. Very excited that they haven't declined quite as much as what we were expecting. In total, as I mentioned, we counted 92,000 bank swallows along the entire North Shore.
So currently in Atlantic Canada, as I mentioned earlier, rock armoring or using cement walls or blocks to prevent shoreline erosion is very common. So we are planning to work with partners to create an example of a living shoreline site. Living shorelines is a technique for shoreline stabilization using a combination of natural materials such as coastal plants, wood debris, logs, sand, and rock placed strategically to slow wave action and protect the shore. The photo on the left shows an eroding shoreline before stabilization, and the photo on the right shows a mix of rock and vegetation used to protect the shoreline and prevent erosion. The example site we will create will use similar techniques, but at a site where a bank swallow colony is already established. We hope that we can use this site to show how successful living shorelines can be at preventing erosion, and how this more natural method to stabilizing shorelines can help protect bank swallow nesting habitat. So how can you help these awesome birds? Start off with chimney swifts. If you do have a brick or clay chimney, you can help provide nesting and roosting habitat by keeping the top of your chimney open from April to October. Try to clean your chimney in March before spring migration begins and after fall migration ends. If you are renovating your house and you're thinking about getting rid of that chimney, you could consider leaving it up for birds and open for birds. And lastly, if you live in an area with a lot of chimneys, take a look up at dusk. You might find a nest or roost site that we don't know about yet, like this video I took of a completely unexpected chimney swift nest in downtown Toronto this summer. You can just see the swift fly into the chimney at the end there. For barn swallows, you can keep your garage, shed, or barn doors open during spring and summer months so that barn swallows can access the nesting habitat. You can further encourage them to nest in your barn or shed by adding ledges or nest cups to flat walls that are at least 2 inches below the roof or the overhang. To further encourage nesting, you can keep a mud source nearby so that barn swallows can use it to build their nest. For bank swallows, they often nest near popular beaches or waterways in the summer. If you notice holes along the banks or see bank swallows flying around, please keep your distance from the birds in the colony. If you are a coastal or waterfront property owner with erosion problems, please consider using natural techniques to help control the erosion rather than rock armoring. To help all birds and the insects that many birds depend on, you can plant a garden. A bird garden has a few main features, including planting native plants with structural diversity. Native plants use less water and pesticides than non-native plants. Structural diversity includes things like leaving leaf litter, adding flowering plants, shrubs, and deciduous and conifer trees to gardens. The more diverse a garden, the more diverse its inhabitants. Water features are a great addition so that birds can drink and bathe, especially during the hot summer months. And finally, birdhouses can provide nesting habitat for cavity nesters like the tree swallow. To help you get started, Birds Canada has created a website, birdgardens.ca, where you can plan your garden, identify what plants are native in your area, and see a list of potential bird visitors and more. Another easy way to help birds is to put stickers on your windows to prevent birds from colliding with them. A 2013 report found that an average of 22.4 million birds die annually in Canada from collisions with windows. During the day, birds will fly into windows if they can see the reflection of trees or vegetation, or if they can see a plant inside the window. Nocturnal birds will also fly into windows at night if there's a light shining through. This is because nocturnal birds use light from the moon to navigate, getting mixed up when they see light from a window. Stickers on the window will break up the reflection and make the glass look like a barrier. In order for stickers to be effective, they need to be placed in a dense 5 cm by 5 cm pattern. They need to be applied to the outside of the window. There needs to be a high contrast between the glass and the stickers. And finally, the stickers have to cover the entire window. And if you would like more information about this, you can visit flap.org. And I believe they even sell the little dot stickers on there. Again, in 2013, the same report estimated that cats kill an average of 196 million breeding birds annually in Canada. 116 million are killed by feral cats, and 80 million are killed by domestic pet cats. Cats kill more breeding birds in Canada annually than any other source of death. In fact, cat predation, collision with house and building windows, and collisions with vehicles and transmission lines all together cause 95% of breeding bird deaths in Canada. You can help with this by keeping cats indoors. If your cat is used to going outside, you can try putting your cat on a leash or build a cat patio or catio, like this picture on the left that has three cats inside of it, so that they can go out safely. If you have barn cats or know of a feral colony, you can work with your local humane society if they run a trap, neuter, return programs. Trap, neuter, return programs humanely reduce the cat population over time, and they can receive other medical care if needed. You can also help by volunteering with us. Our Swift Watch program covers Ontario, Manitoba, Quebec, and the Maritimes, and includes roost monitoring and nest watching. Roost watching occurs annually at known sites across Canada on the dates listed here. You can report casual observations of nests or do presence-absence surveys of chimneys in your neighborhood. If you're interested in more information, you can contact us via the two emails listed here if you live in Ontario or Atlantic Canada, or visit our Swift Watch website if you live elsewhere. If you live in Atlantic Canada, we have just started a new bank swallow monitoring program. The program only requires one visit to a colony each year between May and July. The only equipment needed is binoculars, a pencil, and a phone or some way to get location information. If you are interested in learning more about this program, you can email me or visit our website on Nature Counts. If you can't volunteer, but you happen to see a bank swallow colony in Atlantic Canada, please report the location to me. And again, you can send it to my email, which is listed here. You can also use your vote to support climate action and policies. As explained earlier, climate change is impacting species around the globe and having multiple effects on Canada's aerial insectivore populations. We need stronger policies to help protect them. And finally, you can get out and bird. If you're new to birding, here's a list of apps, websites, and books that can help you with identifying species. And of course, if you're out birding, there are several places you can report sightings and contribute to citizen science projects, including eBird, iNaturalist, and Nature Counts. Thank you to everyone who made it out to hear this presentation today, and a huge thank you to our partners, funders, and donors that help Birds Canada achieve our conservation goals. So now we have time for questions, and thank you all again for listening.
So there's been a bunch of questions on the question board. Give me 2 seconds to pull everything up. Yeah. Okay. So the first question was, how do you find out where chimney swifts live? If you like see them in your backyard or that sort of thing. And the answer to that is that wander around your neighborhood and see if you see any chimney swifts diving into chimneys headfirst. Go look around, like in the spring and late summer, around dawn and dusk, especially dusk. If you watch a chimney for about an hour, like half an hour before sunset, until half an hour after sunset, that will be the time when chimney swifts are going into roost that night. I will actually look around on Google Earth, and I'll look for chimneys that look like they're not capped and that they might be open, that chimney swifts might be using. And then I'll base where I go and look off of that. But basically, if you wander around, you should be able to find something if you live in, especially an older type of city. Another question was about violet green swallows, and I haven't dealt with those at all personally, because I live in Ontario and they're more of a Western species, but the question was about their status, like how are they doing in compared to other species. So I quickly Googled it, and they're actually not doing that bad. They've only declined by 28% since 1996. Since between 1966 and 2015, whereas bank swallows, in comparison, have declined by 93% in that time. So in comparison, violet green swallows are doing quite well. Chelsea asked about the video of the chimney swifts roosting in Toronto, and she was wondering if you had a bit more details on that, Heather.
Well, I was dog sitting for my friend in her Toronto apartment and was out on her balcony when I noticed a bunch of swifts, chimney swifts, zooping around. There's five of them. And I just, because I know what to look for, I knew that they were chimney swifts. And I was like, there's a chimney right there. I'm just going to sit down and watch this. And so it took me 2 or 3 days, I think, to actually get the video of them diving in, because I don't know if you could see how quickly it happens, but it's they're there 1 second and then diving in the next. So that was, as far as I know, a new chimney swift nest that we hadn't heard about before. And it's right on Dundas Street, right downtown Toronto. So they can literally be anywhere. And you just got to remember to look up at dusk and look at chimneys.
And could you tell if that chimney was capped? That was more specifically Chelsea's question.
Was what? Sorry?
It looked like there was a bit of a cap or something on it. I don't know if it was just a different chimney than the one that was right up front.
Yeah, you know, they definitely had a way to get in. So I don't know if it was capped. I think a cap usually has like stilts and then a screen on top, so you would really be able to see it. I wish I got a picture of the chimney next to it that was capped. So they definitely couldn't go in there. But I think there was a picture of how it kept. So it's more like this. So you see how there's, if you can still see my screen here, there's mesh around the nest. So that would be a cap chimney. And so it was still open and they were able to get in.
Hey, Victoria, I work at Pinery Provincial Park and we recently received some funding from ECCC for bank swallows. We are planning on creating rolling boardwalks to direct traffic, post signage along the banks, and transplant marum grasses, I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing that wrong, along the shoreline. Would you have any other suggestions on what we could do to further improve their habitat, or any suggestion on what to specifically look for when surveying them? So mostly bank swallows like that eroding cliff face, like that bluff habitat. So making sure that you have any of that sort of habitat open for them. They will also occasionally use like piles of dirt. So just leaving that sort of stuff up will help to create some bank swallow habitat. Having the rolling boardwalks and posting signage along the bank sounds awesome. Like a big thing about protecting these species is just educating the public, because if they don't know about them, they don't care about them. And then like when I was surveying along from Nanticoke to Dunville, it was completely rock armored, that whole stretch. So like, there's no habitat at all. So just educating the public will go a long way, because maybe they'll think twice about completely covering that bank with rocks.
Yeah, I'll just add, I think a few things to keep track of too, is so the less vegetation is better, especially on on the eroding side. So if there's vegetation at the top, that's okay. But vegetation allows predators to get in more easily. So just keeping a nice, clear sand face that's also at least 70 degrees vertical or more would be a great start. And for specific suggestions on what to look for when surveying, we just actually, in Atlantic Canada, we just created a whole protocol for how we want to monitor them. And you'd be more than welcome to look at that. You can either email me or check out our Nature Counts website, and it's posted there. So that would help with what to look for when surveying.
I'm sorry, I'm going to pronounce your name wrong. Zara? Sorry. I have a quick question. Sometimes birds are coming to our balcony and we give foods, but at the end, birds make some dirt, especially in the summer. In your opinion, should I stop feeding the birds? I'm not sure quite what you mean by dirt. But I, in general, though, I don't know if I can find you and allow you to talk if you'd like. But in general, feeding the birds is awesome. It's a great way to supplement their food sources, and it really helps people engage with birds, because again, if you don't know about birds, you're not going to care about them as much, especially like the general public. So I'm a big advocate for feeding birds and that sort of thing, as long as you do it responsibly. So on a balcony, make sure that you have like window stickers up, so that they're not accidentally hitting the walls. If you notice any bird that has some sort of bird flu or some sort, it will look really obvious. Then maybe put your bird feeders away. Make sure you're cleaning your bird feeders regularly. Put out a variety of food, all that sort of thing. But as long as you're doing it responsibly, there's no reason that you need to stop feeding them. I think that we have the feeder watch coordinator on here, actually. I'll allow her to talk if she wants. I don't know if she's paying attention. Carrie, I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hi, if you're feeding birds from a balcony, you can sometimes attract lots of species. As long as you have lots of vegetation and lots of habitat up there, it's fantastic. And yes, as long as you're feeding responsibly, I think bird feeding is a great way to connect with nature and for people to care about birds.
Awesome, thanks. I'm sorry, I'm going to butcher your name as well. Paloma? Is there any data on the type of habitat that swifts used before there were chimneys? Yes, they like nested and roosted in old forest hollow trees. So when Europeans started colonizing North America, they cut down all these old growth forests, but they also at that same time were building all these houses with these old stone chimneys. So chimney swifts just transitioned straight from these old growth forests to the chimneys, and there's still records of chimney swifts nesting in these huge hollow trees. There was a paper written fairly recently about a study in Quebec where they put some MODIS tags on, they put some sort of radio tags on chimney swifts, and they actually tracked them to their natural nesting site, which is pretty cool. Derek, since chimney swifts naturally use the likes of hollow trees, you just answered my question. Is it possible / feasible to build artificial habitat, meaning something like a wooden box? So this is a tricky question, because in Texas, they build these wooden structures that's just like a tube, and the chimney swifts love it. The chimney swifts take to it no problem. It's like, it's a couple grand to build. It's working really well. But in Canada, we're not having any luck with this, really. There's been maybe a couple cases out of like 100 tries with this wooden type. It's called Kyle and Kyle, who published a book that explained how to do all that. Using this Kyle and Kyle structure in Canada, we haven't had much luck. But big stone masonry structures that have, potentially because it has more insulation, this seems to be working a lot better. Birds Canada, the Atlantic team, was actually involved in building a structure. Bridgetown, Nova Scotia, if I'm remembering correctly. I don't know, Heather, if you've got some more details on that.
I'm not about the location, but I do know what happened was a school was getting torn down that had a big chimney as part of it that was a known roost site. And they were debating what to do, and they decided to just leave the chimney up and build the school kind of off to the side of the chimney. So there is that possibility, too, that as these older buildings get replaced with newer ones, we can just leave the chimney up. And it sort of is, in a way, a way of replacing of building more artificial habitat, just leaving them up. And that's where our chimney fund comes in as well. We can help people keep chimneys up for these swifts.
Awesome. Another person, how can I get involved with bird banding? I'd love to volunteer for the spring migration in 2023. So you have to go through the Birds Canada website, find LPBO, Long Point Bird Observatory, and then you apply to come and band. So I think if you've never banded before, you have to commit to, I think it's a month for the first time you come out, so that they like have time to train you up. You would have to talk to somebody that works in the banding office though. So yeah, you can go through the Birds Canada website and you can find all that information. Deborah, we've seen wooden barn swallow structures in different parks. Are they successful in attracting barn swallows? So the answer is yes and no. Some of them do really well, some of them don't. A lot of the time, barn swallow structures are put up to replace barns. And I personally find that replacing a huge barn that holds 70 pairs of barn swallows isn't adequately replaced by a tiny little structure that can house maybe 5 pairs. So, like, yes, they do get barn swallows. They're not spectacular, and it depends on the location and how it's built. So if it's a larger structure and it has walls, it has predator guards, and it doesn't have a ton of human disturbance, it's going to be a lot more successful than a little tiny thing that's put up and doesn't have all those safety features for them, because they're just going to get predated. So yes and no, depends on how it's built and a lot of things. Ian, I haven't been feeding birds this summer due to avian bird flu. Is it okay to restart? I'm going to skip that question to the feeder watch coordinator as well.
Hi, avian flu is really, this strain of avian flu is really targeting poultry and waterfowl and not really affecting feeder birds. So we're asking people to just listen to what their local municipalities are suggesting and to follow your local guidelines. But there are no federal guidelines for bird feeding at this point.
Awesome. Thank you. I did not have a response to that question.
Yeah, thank you for being here, Carrie.
Paloma, I'm sorry again if I pronounced your name wrong. So would the birds have used other holes made by other species, and would the old growth have been deciduous or evergreen? I honestly don't know specifically. So one paper that I read, it was a deciduous tree that they were nesting in, and it's like old, hollowed out. So like it's not like a woodpecker cavity where they've like dug a hole into the side. It's like the tree is hollowed out. Sometimes there will be like hollowed branches and they can go in through those sides, but so it's more like old and it's kind of rotted out. I guess something could have made a hole, but I don't really think so.
I'm wondering, I don't know this for sure, this is a hypothesis, but that before human populations got so big, there used to be a lot of natural fires that would have occurred, and then we started suppressing them. So fires could be the driving force behind creating those old growth cavity trees, burning out the inside, the rest of the tree stands tall, and then all of the chimney swifts could have fit right into those trees. And I'm guessing it would have been a mixed wood forest, just like what we have now, just much older, and they would have nested in anything that had a cavity, I would assume, but I'm again not positive.
That's all the questions that were typed up. Does anybody have anything else that they are in that they'd be interested in asking? All right, well, thank you so much for joining us. I really hope you enjoyed this and that you've learned something. Feel free to shoot us an email if you have any other questions you come up with or you'd like to get involved. And thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone, for being here. I hope you all learned something today. And we look forward to hearing from you if you're interested in learning more.